Well, good morning and welcome to St. James Presbyterian Church. Thank you so much for being with us this day, and thank you so much for continuing to help keep us safe as we gather together by wearing our masks when we are indoors. We continue to celebrate our community, both in our worship services here, in the Sunday school programs that are going on, and we thank you so much for making it possible for the service and ministry of our church to continue. We also thank the Sieberts who are sharing the flowers with us today in celebration of their 57th wedding anniversary. Blessings to you on this day. Next week, we have a special celebration. As you know, Sherry Bates is concluding her 9 years of ministry here, and they have moved over to the desert, to La Quinta, and we are going to be celebrating that ministry in a luncheon following our worship service. We invite you to stay for that, and we'll be having an opportunity to express our appreciation to Sherry for all the ways that she has blessed us and our children and our families over the course of her time with our congregation. Lastly, there is a schedule. There have been a number of persons who have inquired about becoming members of our congregation, and we'd like to invite anyone who is interested in at least finding out about what membership means, what our church is about, what it means to become a member of our congregation. We'll be having an inquirer's class on two Sundays, October the 10th and the 17th, following our worship services. If you are interested in something like that, there's no commitment being made. It's probably about more information. If you could just let Jan know at the welcome table, we can make sure we have adequate numbers of materials provided for people, and we look forward to then having you be able to raise any questions or interests that you would have about our congregation. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God. Everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, you made us so that our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Give us courage and strength of purpose that no selfish passion may hinder us from knowing your will. No weakness may keep us from doing it, and then in your light we may see light clearly. Bless us, Lord, that what we do and how we do it will bring honor to the name of Jesus, the Christ and our Lord and Savior. Amen. I invite you to stand and join us as together we sing our opening song. Over the last month, we've been taking a look at the stories of the patriarchs as they are found in the gospel, or in the first book of the Bible called Genesis. We took a look first at the story of Abraham and said that God's blessing is always a calling to become and do something. It is always a blessing that has a responsibility of blessing others. And Abraham is offered as an example of faithfulness of how you deal with a God who makes promises to us. Last week, we began taking a look at the second patriarch story, the one about Jacob. And in that, we said that the story of Jacob is about the irony of God's blessing. For Jacob thinks that God's blessing is sort of an asset that he can claim, a possession that he can take control of, something that becomes a matter of manipulation for reaching and achieving his own agenda. And when you treat a blessing as a possession, it becomes worthless. Worthless to Jacob and to anyone else. Well, we said really what God's blessing is a relationship. That God's blessing is to undergo a relationship in which we expect to find God at work in our lives. And as we've talked about before, every relationship has life through expressions, through exchanges that take place between people. And there are two occasions that are talked about where God and Jacob encounter and have such an exchanging of expressions. The first one we took a look at last week was at Bethel, where Jacob has left his family, feels like he is alone in the world. Nobody knows him. Nobody cares for him. He's wondering what life can hold. And he discovers God is present with him. And God says, I will be with you as you build that future. He then has a second encounter with God that we take a look at this evening. This is taking place some 24 years later. And he has achieved financial success. He has had a family that now at this point has 11 children. He is returning back to his homeland to encounter his estranged brother Esau. And as he begins to anticipate this moment with both anxiety and hope and fear, he has a second encounter with God, and it's narrated in the 32nd chapter. So I invite you to follow along as we read the encounter of God and Jacob at Jabbok. That same night, he, Jacob, got up and took his two wives, his two maidservants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was alone. And a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called that place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Lord God, as we take a look at these ancient words, it's our hope and prayer that we will also hear your voice speaking to us this day. Touch, renew, and refresh us, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A number of years ago, Tim Allen, the actor and comedian, was being interviewed, and he had this to talk about his life journey. His father died when Alan was just 11 years old. A drunk driver had crashed into their car as his dad was driving home from a college football game. Nearly 50 years later, Alan says that his father's death changed everything forever. In the interview that he had, he says, "Part of me still doesn't trust anything will work out right. I knew my father was dead, but I was never satisfied with why he was dead. I wanted answers the minute from God. Do you think this is funny, God? Do you think this is necessary? And I've had a tumultuous relationship with God ever since. We are people who want life to make sense. We go through, and oftentimes when things go well, we are saying, oh, that's the way life is supposed to be. But when life doesn't go well, we think something is wrong. How can we make sense of what is happening to me? And part of that then impacts who we turn to for answers to that question. I remember the first time I was doing a memorial service. I was still in the middle of seminary, as a matter of fact. And it was the funeral service for an elementary age child who had died in a house fire. And one of the searing moments of that was his mother coming to me and asking the question, why did this happen? And when she asked, why did this happen? She was not asking, well, was there an electrical outlet short that somehow caused the conflagration? Or why does flesh can be consumed by flames? Or why is it that this type of trauma leads to death? No, she was asking, how can I make sense of this moment? What does it mean? How can I move forward? And at that point, we wonder, where is God fitting in all of this? Back in 2013, there were a number of devastating tornadoes that tore through the state of Oklahoma. And Lifeway Research completed a survey talking about suffering and faith. And people were asked, how do you feel about God when suffering occurs that seems unfair? 33% said, well, even in that moment, I trust God more. 25% said, I'm confused about God. 16% says, I don't even think about God at all in these circumstances. 11% said, I wonder if God cares. 8% of us confessed, I'm angry or resentful at God. And 7% says, it just shows God doesn't exist. We want our lives to make sense. And what this story about Jacob reminds us is that God is willing to wrestle with us in these moments. It's not, don't think about it, don't worry about it, this is not something to bring up with God. It is indeed saying, here is a moment in which God is willing to walk with us to wrestle through it. Faithfulness is not trying to make this tragedy acceptable. That there's some reason that we can say, okay, that's the way it ought to be. Some persons try to make that message when they say, God has a purpose in everything, and so the purpose is this had to happen. Quite frankly, that's not a biblical approach to understanding life. There are things that happen that are not God's intention or will. There are tragedies that take place. And not anything happens because God wants it that way. What faith is the courage to struggle through that moment with God. As Jacob said in verse 28 here, I'm not letting you go till you bless me. And the man said, what's your name? And he answered, Jacob. Jacob, which means the grasper, the one who is going to take control of life. And the man says, but no longer. From now on, your name is Israel, God wrestler. You've wrestled with God, and you'll come through. So how do we faithfully wrestle with God? How do we make this a moment that can become an instant of blessing? Well, the first thing, I think, is to understand that we wrestle with God not by complaining about God, but complaining to God. If you read through the Bible, there are lots of biblical complainers. There's Job, probably most famously, who complains to God that he is being mistreated for his faithfulness. There is Moses, who complains to God about all the circumstances of his responsibilities of leadership of the people rescued from Egypt. David and Jeremiah are persons who famously complain to God about what's going on in their life, and what does God have to offer in getting through those moments. And if you look at the Psalms, which is the songbook of the ancient temple in Jerusalem, among the variety of songs there are what are called laments. And what the laments are basically complaints to God about when life is going wrong. In the 142nd Psalm we read in the first three verses, I call to the Lord for help, I plead with him, I bring him all my complaints, I tell him all my troubles, and when I'm ready to give up, he knows what I should do. You see, complaining to God is worship. Complaining about God is rebellion. It's like when a married couple is having a challenge and one of the spouses goes and complains about their spouse to somebody else rather than raising their complaint with their spouse. In doing that, it only widens and weakens the relationship rather than making any change or building possible. So we begin by wrestling faithfully with God by complaining to God rather than about God. The second thing in wrestling faithfully with God is remembering God's character. It is understanding who it is that we are complaining to and asking for some response back. What is the context for expecting this conversation to unfold and to continue? And what the biblical story is all about is we know some things about this God's character that gives us an encouragement to know that our complaint will not fall on deaf ears. The first is that God is compassionate, that God intends what is good for us. God has our best interests at heart. Again, the psalmist says in the 145th Psalm, God is good to all. He has compassion on all that he has made. And the most clear representation of that is in the ministry mission of Jesus, who comes to let us know that God loves us and is willing to begin anew with us, regardless of what has happened in the past, and is willing even to bear the cost of that graciousness. It is remembering that God is compassionate and that we can face such a God with confidence that he has our best interests at heart. The second thing that the Bible says is God is also consistent, that God's expression of compassion is not something that will wane or wear out, that God will seek to live through this moment with us. In Romans 11:29, we read, God never changes his mind about the people he calls and the things that he gives them. God says, we are going to get through this thing. And third, that we are invited to be persistent in our engagement with that relationship. That we are looking to see, even if I haven't heard the response yet, to continue to engage God. In our story, Jacob says in verse 26, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And Jesus also tells us that faithfulness is being persistent with God, even in the face of delay. In the 18th chapter of Luke, we read this story that Jesus told his disciples. Beginning with the first verse, he says, Jesus told them a story showing that it was necessary to pray consistently and never quit. He said, there was once a judge in some city who never gave God a thought and cared nothing for the people. A widow in that city kept after him. My rights are being violated. Protect me, she requested. He never gave her the time of day. But after this went on and on, he said to himself, I care nothing what God thinks, and even less what other people think. But because this widow won't quit badgering me, I better do something and see that she gets justice. Otherwise, I'm just going to end up beaten back and blue by her pouncing. Then the master said, do you hear what that judge, corrupt as he is saying? So what makes you think God won't step in and work justice for his chosen people who continue to cry out for help? Won't he stick up for them? I assure you, he will. What Jacob's example is for us is that there are going to be moments when we say, this just doesn't make sense. God, help me through it. Oftentimes those struggles come in the midst of disappointment and sometimes even tragedy. But those are the moments in which we begin to feel and discover the reality of what a difference God can make. We wrestle with God not to defeat God, but to engage God with our hopes, our dreams, and our fears. And what the example of Jacob provides for us is that when I fight faithfully, I too will emerge blessed. Will you pray with me? Lord, you know what I struggle with. You know those questions that nag, those challenges that seem intractable, those hurts that don't go away. At first, Lord, I thought I didn't need you. I could do it. I will get through this. And then I tried to get you to do what I wanted. But now, Lord, I'm willing to absorb the pain of engaging you. I will not let you go. And I ask you to get me through this. Bless me, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Stripped away, I will simply come.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you, Jesus.
I'll never know how much it costs.
When it's all about you, it's all about you, and I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'm coming back to the heart. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you.
All together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. And it's all about you, Jesus.
Prayer is an expression of our wrestling with God, for it is an expression that we expect to find God at work in our lives. And because of that, we raise before God those things that are on our hearts, those things that we celebrate and take joy in, those things that we have questions about, need guidance for, and seek God's help. And so on Sunday mornings, we pray, but we also invite persons to help us direct our prayers. And so if you have a thing that you are especially thankful for and take joy in, or a concern that you would like us to raise in our prayers this morning, we would like to include that. Are there any requests this day? Okay.
A prayer of praise that my oldest daughter, who had the knee injury, is doing better, that Debbie is coming back on Monday, and will return in October when she actually has the operation. So traveling mercies for Debbie's safe return, and prayers of praise.
Thank you. Yes.
Blessing that after 3 weeks in the hospital, my dad is home and feels really good.
That's excellent. Then let us turn to our Lord in prayer. Lord our God, we begin by giving thanks. For giving thanks for this beautiful world that you have entrusted to our care. The warmth of sunlight, the wetness of rain and snow, for all that nourishes the earth, for the beauty of the splendor entrusted to us. But we also thank you, Lord, for the presence and power of your Spirit at work in our lives, a Spirit that encourages us to grow and to mature and to become all that you intend us to be, that walks with us in these moments, a Spirit that you provide the energy, enthusiasm, and inspiration that we might be your partners in the good work of blessing. We thank you for the support and encouragement that we have received from others who have seen in us something to encourage and to build upon. And we thank you for those who provide public safety and well-being that make it possible for us to live together with safety and with hope. And we thank you, Lord, for this church and the community of faith that we are a part of. In this church, we find comrades and companions to work and to journey together in discovering how your Spirit is at work here. Merciful God, strengthen us in our prayer life as we lift up the brokenness of the world for your healing and share in the responsibility of making things better. We celebrate that Danette is doing better. We know it is not done yet and surgery is still ahead, but we give you thanks for the signs of your healing grace at work in her. We pray, Lord, that Debbie will return home safely and continue to offer that support and encouragement. We give you thanks to Frank, who is home from the hospital now, and we pray, Lord, that your strength will continue to grow in him. Work through the doctors and staff that attend him and the family that supports him, that he might know of your strength being offered. We pray, Lord, for those in positions of authority over others, that what they do and how they do it may make your justice possible and express your compassionate respect. We pray for those who wonder if anyone cares or feels forgotten. May we be the instruments that let them know that they are not alone nor forgotten. We pray for children without families or homes. We pray for those who are instruments of your caring and relief. We pray, Lord, for your Spirit to be at work in us. Lord, you already know what is going on in our hearts and in our circumstances. But as we give expression to it, we give expression that we expect to find you with us. So, Lord, in the quiet of this moment, hear our prayers as we face the week ahead. Thank you, Lord. We know of your love, of your commitment, of your capacity shown in Jesus. And so together, we pray the prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand and sing our concluding song. We've been gathered here as a family of faith. We go out now as the ambassadors of Christ. Jesus asks us to render to no person evil for evil, but to strengthen the faint-hearted, to support the weak, to honor each and every person that we meet as a brother or sister in Christ. And Jesus also promises that if we're willing to do that, we will discover that the Spirit of God is with us and will work through us. So may God our Father, Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Savior and our Lord, and the Holy Spirit be with you today and tomorrow and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.